this until I kissed ya. How did I exist until I kissed ya? Never had you on my mind. Now you're there all the time. Never knew what I missed till I kissed ya. Uh-huh, I kissed ya. I kissed ya, uh-huh. My life's not the same now that I kissed ya. Oh yeah, you got a will about ya. Now I can't live without ya. Never knew what I missed till I kissed ya. Uh-huh, I kissed ya. And I didn't realize what a kiss could be. You got a will about you. Now I can't live without you. Never knew what I missed till I kissed you. Uh-huh, I kissed you. Oh yeah, I kissed you. Uh-huh, I kissed you.
Magic 92.5 WGHQ.
Let someone start believing in you. Let him hold out his hand. Let him touch you and watch. What happens when someone who can look in your eyes and see into your heart, let him find you and watch what happens? Cold, no, I won't believe your heart is cold. Maybe just afraid. Give that deep love to you, and what magic you'll see. Let someone give his heart, someone who cares like me. Let someone give his heart who cares like me.
This is the Hudson Valley station for great songs and magic memories. 920 WGHQ AM Kingston and 92.5 W223 CR FM Kingston, New York. We're streaming through our website, WGHQ.FM, and you can listen on your smart speaker when you say play WGHQ. This is Magic 92.5 WGHQ with another hour of great songs and magic memories, starting right now.
I always wondered how I'd live without you, if you ever said goodbye. Would I just live in dreams about you, with tears in my eyes? Would I fall to pieces when you go? I always wondered how I'd live without you. Now I know
I'm doing all right. Strong enough to make it on my own. I'm not afraid of the night. I'm learning how to face it alone.
I've been good at holding on. Now I'm learning to let go. I always wondered what I'd do without you. I found out today.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
Hi, I'm Steve Thomas for Habitat for Humanity Restore. Habitat Restores are nonprofit home improvement stores and donation centers that sell new and gently used furniture, building materials, and appliances to the public at a fraction of the retail cost. The Ulster County Restore at 406 Route 28 in Kingston needs your donations. Call our hotline at 845-853-7499 to schedule your free pickup. And thanks.
We all play a role in keeping our community safe.
Every day, we move in and out of each other's busy lives.
It's easy to take for granted all the little moments that make up our everyday.
Some are good, others not so much.
But that's life.
It's when something doesn't seem quite right
that it's time to pay attention.
Because only you know what's not supposed to be in your everyday.
So protect your everyday.
If you see something suspicious, say something to local authorities. Hi, this is Jared Mans from the Spring Lake Fire Department, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
This programming is brought to you by the Friends of Kevin Cahill. As a strong advocate of local broadcasting, Assemblymember Cahill urges you to support Kingston Community Radio with your time and donations. Your contributions keep KCR vital and on the air at FM 92.5, AM 920, and on the web at mykcr.org. Please join Assemblymember Cahill and send your gifts of $10, $25, or more to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York, 12402. Together, let's keep KCR alive.
All right, you're on. Okay, good morning. Good morning, Kingston.
Hello, Kingston. Boy, 2 weeks goes by.
Mario and Huey here this morning.
Mario and Huey, we're back.
Freezing, but here. Yeah. What's with this spring huge?
Disappeared, Mar. I don't think it's ever going to come back. It's global warming. Wait a minute, that's backwards.
Oh, yeah, it's going the opposite way.
We could use a little global warming.
We could use a little local warming.
Local warming.
Oh, man. Anyway, listen, since last we spoke, you've done a couple of blogs. Anything of interest in those blogs of yours that you want to talk about?
Well, I'm more of a current events guy, Mayor.
Okay.
But, you know, thanks for tossing it my way. It was in the papers yesterday that Gordon Liddy died. For some of our younger listeners, that might not ring a bell anymore. But Gordon Liddy was, in his obituary, which was extensive, was identified as one of the planners of the Watergate break-in and the subsequent history. But his roots go back to Ulster County. Dutchess County. Dutchess County. He was an assistant district attorney over there.
Mm-hmm.
And a candidate for Congress in 1968.
Wow.
Against Ham Fish and John Dyson. I mean, this is getting back there. But
that's before I got here.
My connection to, not to drop names, which I do all the time, reporters live vicarious lives. They're not famous themselves, but they touch.
Well, you touch a lot of people.
There was a in the late summer of 68. There was a Vietnam symposium out at Ulster, what was then called Ulster County Community College, and the coordinator of the symposium called me up at about 4 o'clock on a Friday afternoon. And he said that they had this panel set up, but it was people who were against the war. And they needed somebody. They couldn't find anybody to speak for the war. Well, by 1968, there weren't a lot of people speaking for the war other than General Westmoreland. And so he says, do you know anybody who could appear tonight? I know it's short notice, but, you know, we haven't had any luck with anybody. So I said, "Yeah, call Resnick, the congressman. He's for the war." He goes, "We tried Resnick." He said, and "This was the first inkling I had that Joe Resnick had finally seen the light." Yeah. And Resnick himself was running in a four-way Senate Democratic primary for U.S. Senate that year.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so there was a lot of lot of wheels in motion. So I said, I'll tell you what. Give me your phone number. I know a guy over in Dutchess County who's on the ballot, but he's not running. He's a conservative candidate, but he withdrew. Liddy had, and a deal was done as things happened. So I called the Dutchess County District Attorney's office, and Liddy picks up the phone.
Oh, geez.
Yeah. Say hello. Yeah. Hi, Gordon. Hugh Reynolds from the Daily Freeman. Now, he didn't know who I was, but
yeah.
the Daily Freeman probably rang a bell. Ulster was part of the district.
Yeah, yeah. Sure.
And I told him we had a symposium out of the college in about 2 hours, 3 hours, and they didn't have anybody to speak for the war. So I said, I know you're against it. The reason he was against it, he didn't think they were prosecuting it well enough. He wanted to literally nuke North Vietnam.
Oh, okay.
That's Gordon, you know.
Yeah,
Gordon
yeah,
Lee.
Yeah, yeah.
So Liddy says to me, hey, it's not a problem. And he said, if you know the facts about any situation, you can argue either side. And so he said, I'll be there.
Okay.
And called him up. I didn't cover it. I should have.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it was Friday night, man. It's party time. You know, you remember Kingston in the good old days?
Yeah.
You know, I had things to do. And anyway, I called the kid, the coordinator, on Monday morning, and he said, oh, it was a riot. He said, that guy Liddy, he said, he lit up the place. He shook his fist. The kids were screaming at him. They were throwing stuff. And he defended that war. It was quite an event.
Yeah, yeah. And I don't think a lot of people know, and I probably, as you said, a lot of our audience probably doesn't even remember, but Liddy was on the ballot to run for Congress. He was, I believe,
conservative.
As a conservative. And Ham Fish, the incumbent, if I'm not mistaken, or
Fish was a candidate. Had lost the previous 2 years.
Oh, okay, had lost. Okay. So he was a little concerned about not having the conservative line, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
He needed that to win. So I think the rumor has it that a deal was made to get Liddy a job in Washington.
Yeah.
Closer to the Watergate complex. And history was made right there in some back room in Dutchess County.
Yes, it was. And flash forward a few years, Fish's father, Fish Sr., Fish's father in the 1966 campaign bought billboards, unknown to Fish, the son, bought billboards around the district that said, "Vote for Ham Fish Jr., a real American." Now, the Fishes were Brahmins. I mean, they went back to the Revolutionary War.
Oh, yeah, right. Absolutely.
Hamilton Fish. The Hamilton Fishes were named after Alexander Hamilton.
Right, right.
Way back. One of the most distinguished American families were the Fishes. Mm. Whereas the Resniks, Resnik beat Fish in 66. The Resniks were, I believe their parents were immigrants, like from that era, a lot of people who came
over. Oh, sure, yeah.
And coincidentally, Jewish. And so putting something up, a billboard up that said, "Vote for a real American," had implications.
And so, that seat was open in 68?
It was open.
Right, Resnik was in a primary for Senate.
Yes.
So the seat became open.
Yes, yes.
And so that was when Ham Fish got
back.
His first term. Yeah.
And a few years later, I covered Fish speaking at a breakfast at Temple Emmanuel in Kingston. And it was a big crowd. And the interesting thing about Fish Senior and Junior was the Jewish people that I knew that I dealt with in politics hated Ham Fish Senior. They considered him on a par he was an isolationist, and he certainly was not pro Hitler, but they
wanted to keep us out of the war.
Which was a substantial portion of the American public in those days. Fish was well received by most people. In any case, Fish gives his patter. He talks about what's going on in Washington, the usual stuff. And toward the end of his appearance, somebody from the audience raised their hand and said, "Hey, what about Gordon Liddy? You brought Gordon Liddy to Washington." Fish's face got red, and he explained it. He said, for the umpteenth time, how he was not party to that. There was other people, there were political leaders, had nothing to do with it, and blah, blah, blah. And that was the last question, and Fish leaves for the cloakroom. And Fish was a very big man. He was about 6'3", well over 200.
I think he was more than that, because I'm 6'3", and I had to look up to him.
Yeah, he was very big. So was his father.
Yeah.
They were big guys. And Fish went into the... I followed Fish into the cloakroom because I want to ask him something else, typically.
Yeah.
I was behind him. He didn't see me. And he's putting on this overcoat. It was in winter. That looked like a bed sheet, a blanket. I mean, it was a huge guy.
And tent.
I'm looking at the middle of this guy's back, and I'm almost 6 foot tall.
Yeah.
And he's throwing his jacket on. He's mumbling, cursing to himself. "Damn it," he goes. "Every time I go to one of these things, it's either Gordon Liddy or my father that went on." It was a really candid moment, which I, of course, recorded.
Well, thanks for sharing that moment in history and that history of Gordon Liddy. Those are both really interesting stories. So, anyway, for anyone who's awake... this is Kingston Community Radio, 331-9255. We'd love to hear from you. This is the place you can call and say what you please within limits. common courtesy, and we're interested in your ideas, and we're interested in what you have to say. So 331-9255. If you have a Gordon Liddy story, we'd love to hear it. If not, we're going to move on to some current events. Yui, I understand the budget didn't pass yet. Now, it was my understanding was it was supposed to be passed and was mandated or maybe not mandated. But
you know, Mara, that's a curious thing.
It's April 2nd and there's no budget.
There is no budget. Back when the first Cuomo, and well before him, budgets rarely passed by April 1st. And they used to do a thing, you may recall it, where they stopped the clock. The two houses of the legislature would meet all night long and very often run past midnight. And so they would stop the clock at midnight. So it was still March 31st. So they could claim that, well, by our clock, we passed the budget on time. And then after a while, they just didn't care.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the elder Cuomo's budgets passed in August.
Wow.
Yeah, and it just kept rolling along. And then it became a point of honor for Andrew Cuomo to pass a budget on time. And I believe he's done every one of his budgets, which date to 2011.
Yeah,
has passed on time. Some of them several days ahead. So, the question that I raised with Assemblyman Cahill, who's been in office consecutively since 1998, was is this Cahill? Cahill told me that it's not the law; it's more a custom.
Oh, okay. Because I think there are other budget implications. The money runs out.
That's
on
an implication.
March 31st, and then they have to fund things on temporary basis.
Yeah, I think they call messages of necessity to pass this. And the April 1st, which is kind of ironic, it is April Fool's Day after all.
Yeah.
The April 1st deadline, obviously, is in place. Deadline, I think that's more accurate, is in place for school districts to plan their budgets, which come out in middle of May.
Mm.
So that complicates their lives if it's not passed.
So April Fools, any idea of how April 1st became April Fool's Day?
I don't know, but I thought you were playing an April Fool's joke on me yesterday, which we discussed.
So
Catalano and I are out walking, and he says to me, "You know, Reynolds, I can't confirm this, but I heard it from an authoritative source, but that within this massive multi-trillion-dollar federal buyout stimulus package, as it pertains to New York, is that New York has set aside over $1 billion to compensate people who did not who were not eligible for unemployment
because they weren't working.
Well,
they could have been in jail. They could have been illegals that weren't on the books, or people like you who
who was in jail and not on the books,
who should have been in jail but were. So okay.
And so I protested the notion of people who are off the books and were already jobbing the government out of tax revenue, getting rewarded, and then the icing on the cake was, and they will retroactively receive the unemployment benefits that they didn't get, which on average adds up to $26,000 a year, $26,000. I mean, I had that money spent four ways before I got home.
I could see a new car in your
There is a new car.
But anyway, the story I heard about April 1st was that April 1st, with the original calendar that was put forth, April 1st was the beginning of the new year. And as a consequence, New Year's celebrations occurred on April 1st. But when Pope Gregory decided to redo the calendar, and what is now the current calendar, which is known as the Gregorian calendar.
Ah, yes.
They changed New Year's, they changed the first day of the new year to January 1st. However, the word didn't get disseminated across the empire, and on April 1st, there were a number of groups of people who were celebrating, and they became known as April Fools. So
that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, that's the story, and I'm sticking to it because I heard that, and it sounded logical. So it all came down to the Gregorian calendar changing what we and how we celebrated or how we established the first day of the year. So anyway, so I had very interesting this morning. I turned on the radio or TV this morning to watch my my girlfriend Maria Bartiromo. I always like to get her take on things and see what's happening with the market and whatnot, you know. And they were talking about the fact that the CEOs of Coca-Cola and Delta Airlines both came out in opposition to the new Georgia voting law. And there was a pretty spirited discussion. They had, you know, both sides of the issue dealt with. And I'm just wondering, I'd love to hear from some of the folks out there if they're so inclined. Well, we're hearing from them, and I haven't even asked the question. Good morning. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning, gentlemen. Thank you. I appreciate the history, the story that was told at the beginning of the show. And not to interrupt your question, but I was curious, in your opinion, who do you think was one of the most influential governors of the state, and why? Is there a governor that stands out in particular?
I would say, not to date myself, but I would say Rockefeller for very widespread impact.
I would completely agree.
Yeah, and not that's not necessarily endorsing everything he did, but Rockefeller was a visionary, particularly with other people's money. He was a tightwad himself, but just the Albany complex, what do they call it, Rockefeller North,
and the State University. He's the one that expanded. I mean, and put in the four state universities in Albany and Buffalo and Elmira and Stony Brook
and Binghamton, I think.
Yeah. I'm sorry, Binghamton and Stony Brook. Yeah. He was a real proponent of education.
Before Rockefeller, state universities, which I think there's 64 of them now, which, think about it, there's 57 counties and 64 state universities. And before Rockefeller, these were kind of sleepy...
Teachers' colleges, they called them.
Yeah, they were called teachers' colleges, or normal schools.
Normal schools, right.
Many years ago, teachers only needed 2 years at a normal school to get their certificates. The environmental cleanups of our rivers and streams, the federal government followed up on what New York was doing. And in many ways, what Rockefeller was doing in New York was the blueprint for what the federal government was doing. And his impact and his legacy is lasting.
Not to mention the fact that he set an example of how to die.
Well, let's not go into those sort of details. But plus, other than Governor Clinton... Yeah. who, of course, I covered. Rockefeller was the longest-serving governor in our.
He was. I wasn't aware of that.
Yeah, he was elected in '58, and left office, I think, in '72.
Oh wow!
'74 to become vice president.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, right.
Yeah. So listeners can chime in. Maybe
they have other opinions, but
they have other.
But Rocky had a profound effect on the education of New Yorkers. No question about it. I thought it was, if you have to give him credit for one thing, the fact that many of us, myself included, were educated by the state, of New York Education Department, and through the largesse of the state government, I never would have been able to afford dental school had Buffalo not become a state school.
You know, listener, just a personal note, but not my personal note, but a personal note about Rockefeller. He was literally a hands-on type of guy. He was a hugger, and there's a thing they call, when he was trying to convince a legislator or solicit his or her vote.
Yeah.
There was two levels. There was the half Nelson, which was kind of a handshake and a nod, and then there was the full Nelson, where he grabbed your hand, pulled you into his body, threw the other arm around your back, and clutched you to his bosom, and that was the full Nelson.
Yeah.
And if you got the full Nelson, you're generally going his way.
And you weren't driven out of office.
Although he might have been.
Yeah, who knows? Yeah, if he had lived long enough, somebody would have come forward and accused them. Well, listen, caller, thank you so much for that.
Hung up already.
Oh, okay.
All right, so we're talking to...
So...
He was probably listening to your answer on the radio. That's what a lot of them do.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So anyway, I'm listening to Fox Business this morning, and they're talking about the new Georgia voting law.
Yeah.
And they're talking about... the CEO of Coca-Cola and Delta Airlines both coming out and objecting to that law. They're talking about Major League Baseball threatening to pull the All-Star game out of Atlanta. And I'm just interested in what other people, I know what I think. I'm kind of interested in what other people think. You too, Hugh. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this, whether or not it's helpful to bring business and economics into the political arena to try and drive a message that, is it an appropriate response? I mean, I fly on Delta. They're my airline of choice, Delta. Well, I'm going to write to the CEO, and I'm going to say, can you do me a favor? Can you just get me from point A to point B safely and just butt out of, local politics?
Well, these are national politics. I'm of a view my whole career that the more voices that can be heard, the better. I think our elected leaders need to solicit those voices probably before they vote on things, because what they do, as President Obama said, elections have consequences.
Mm-hmm.
And but my problem with this is that I look, unlike a lot of people these days, I look at both sides of these arguments. I look at Fox and I look at CNN.
So do I.
Yeah, I know you do. Yeah. And I'm hearing totally conflicting accounts of this bill. And
yeah.
I don't see anybody moving at all. There's a narrative out there that is, if you want to call it left and right, I think of railroad tracks that just run parallel.
They never intersect.
They never intersect, and I mean, as a couple of examples, there is this provision in the law that does not allow people to be solicited on people who are waiting to get in to vote. Can't be offered water or sustenance while they're waiting in line. Well, I don't know. I've covered elections for a long time, and I've covered elections where people were waiting in line, and nobody came up to them with a glass of water. And so one side says this is an example. I think the president himself, President Biden, said, can you imagine somebody being refused a glass of water, standing in line to vote? Well, that's not what the law says. The law says something quite different.
By the way, the Washington Post gave Biden 4 Pinocchios on that statement, on his statement on the law, because he was so completely out of it. He was claiming also that you couldn't vote after 5 p.m.
Exactly.
And that was incorrect. The polls stay open until 7. And if you're online at 7, you get to vote, even if it's at not until 9 o'clock. The polls, if you're online, you're considered eligible to vote. The doors do not shut until the last person has voted. So I think that I, to a great extent, I agree with you, all voices should be heard. However, people should really do their research and not be taking their guidance from partisan groups. And this is what happened. It appears that the airline and Coca-Cola, they were responding to a partisan group who was unhappy with it, and apparently haven't done. I mean, and there may be issues in that law that are not desirable. So instead of, you know, threatening to pull Major League Baseball out of, you know, the All-Star game, why don't you just say, look, you know, we think this thing should be changed. Let's you know, this is what we think should happen. And in the meantime, I don't know if you saw the reaction to it. The legislature went back into session last night and decided to pull all of Delta's tax breaks in the state of Georgia. You talk about consequences.
Yeah, that's.
I mean, that's even more ridiculous.
Well, if I work for Delta in Atlanta, or I work for Coca-Cola, which has, I think, been operating there since 1880.
They own the state of Georgia.
And that these CEOs can move to Alabama if they choose to.
Yep.
The consequences, the impact on people's lives. But I'd like to see some kind of settled it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen again. And on any issue, it's going to be left and right. But it would be, I'd like to see it settled where people agree on the facts in this case, of a law. It's in black and white.
Yep.
Did you read the law? I get this occasionally. I'll be commenting on or writing about some legislation, and the legislator who sponsored it would call me up and say, hey, did you read the legislation? That's not what it says. But it's the times we live in, and unfortunately, I think it's going to be it will be the times we'll be living in for a long time. I don't think it's going to change. It could get even worse. This country is divided. The Congress is divided. Because people will not talk to each other,
and they will not search for common ground. So a prime example would have been this legislature saying to the folks at Delta, listen, come and sit down and talk to us. We're going to have a hearing. Tell us specifically what your problem is. Instead, you get this knee-jerk reaction. Okay, you guys want to play hardball? Here, try hitting this curveball, and that's what goes on. It's extremely disappointing to me, because all my life I've always felt that, you know, I was a Republican. I've been, you know, I am very comfortable being a Republican. I don't agree with everything. And when I didn't, I tried to change it. However, I always, even when I was on the legislature, got along great with the Democratic legislators, and tried to work with them to understand their points of view, as long as they would listen to my point of view. But those days are long gone. Today, it's in-your-face politics like I've never seen before, and I think I'm fearful that how unhealthy this is for political discourse in this country and the country in general. And I had a very interesting conversation with somebody who was blaming President Trump for killing 500,000 people. Mm. And I asked what the source of that information was, and turns out that CNN had an interview with Dr. Deborah Birx, who now is throwing the Trump administration under the rug.
The bus, so, the bus Mario.
What?
Under
the bus, yes, under the bus. Okay, yeah.
Rugs are different.
I get my rugs and buses.
Buses,
you know,
whatever.
So. But what I thought was interesting was that since Trump left office on January 20th, CNN has lost 42% of their listening and watching audience. Think about that. They've lost 42% of their audience. And I found it ironic that they decided, you know, because they were leading the charge against Trump. There was an anti-Trump every day during the campaign and during his presidency. All they talked about was Trump. and prophetically, Trump predicted that this would happen, and it did. And I want to continue that story. But good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning, Hugh. Good morning, Mario.
Good morning.
I'd like to chime in on that thing where you was talking about with these companies going one way or the other.
Sure.
Personally, I think they ought to just stick to their own business, because all they're going to do is alienate people on either one side of the issue or the other side of the issue, and it's going to be taken out against their employees and stuff by people not buying their products or not using their service. And if they're that upset over the laws in Georgia, why don't they go and take a look at how the state of Delaware, Biden's home state, election laws are working? And this, from what I'd heard and stuff, they're supposed to be even more restrictive than what Georgia is.
They are.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Right. And as far as Major League Baseball goes, they're getting just as bad as the NFL and the NBA. Is people go to sports to get away from all of this. They go to the sports to be able to step back from all of this and watch entertainment. They don't go to sports to get the views and the ideas of the players and nothing else. They go to watch the sports. And Major League Baseball is going to be hurting like the NFL was there for a while, with the Colin Kaepernick issue and the kneeling before the national anthem and stuff. And, people go to sports to get away from everything.
Okay.
And I think they ought to just concentrate on their own business. And, hey, sure, they have their voices in private, but not as a team. And they ought to just stick to what they do best, and that is either playing baseball, playing football, or playing basketball, and leave the politics out of it. Because people trying to get away from the politics issues as it is, because, like you said, there is no compromise anymore. They're so steadfast on either side. And, hey, what they should do is, like, we had John Kuntan over here in the town of Esopus. Once the election was over, he worked for everybody. He didn't, wasn't just a particular party himself. He worked for everybody, and he would listen and talk to everybody that came into his office. I dealt with him many times with the American Legion over here in the town of Esopus. And, hey, the man was fantastic. But these businesses and Major League Baseball and all that ought to just stick to their own business.
Caller, as you know, John died several years ago.
Yes, but, I do. I know, yeah, because he was a big help to the Legion over here. Anything we needed and wanted, he was right there, because he tried many times to get in to the service, but they couldn't take him. But yes, I knew John Coutant well, and we miss him and stuff, and he was a big asset to the American Legion over here in the town of Esopus. And he was one guy that, hey, once the election was over, he was there for the people of the town of Esopus, and that was the way it should be.
He built a pretty nice town hall, didn't he?
Yes, he did. You went from that old garage that was on the corner of Salem Street and Broadway to this nice facility, and that's where we hold our, every other year we hold our Flag Day services at the Veterans Monument that's there on the driveway heading into the town hall on your right side as you're going in. And, they did a good job with it.
Okay, caller, but, thank you.
You guys did a great job on Wednesday, and I appreciate you guys being there to help KCR. And we need more people to contribute to keep this radio station on the air where people can continue to hear everything that, all the information that comes out on both sides. So thank you, gentlemen, and you guys have a great day.
Yes, thanks for the call. Thanks for the call.
Mario, not to prolong this this discussion of the Georgia situation, which a lot of people probably think, well, that's Georgia. You know, what do we care? But when you're CEO of a town's major business, you have a direct line to the governor anyway, or to the majority leader, of influence, and this law went through the process publicly, and these issues were discussed in Georgia, if they wanted meaningful input before the law was passed, they could have done so. That said, the abuses of African Americans traditionally in the South, it's just a really, really terrible period in our history that lasted far too long. I mean, in our lifetimes, this stuff is still going on.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I was at the University of Buffalo when they got an invitation to the Tangerine Bowl, and they were told that the black players would have to stay in a different hotel. And
this is in the 60s, early 60s.
This was 19. It was 1958 or 59. So close to 60. But the point is that they turned down the invitation to play in their first bowl game. The white players voted that they wouldn't go without, you know, having everybody stay at the same hotel, and told them to go scratch. But that was, you know, Tangerine Bowl was a Florida Bowl. And, I mean, I saw that. I experienced it. And, there was the only place I actually never saw it was when I was in the Navy. I didn't see a lot of racial disharmony. I was in the Navy, but I was with the Marines, and there was a lot of brotherhood. Whether you were black, white, purple, green, polka dot, didn't matter. Didn't seem to matter if you
polka dot sailors.
If you had a gun and you were willing to fight, you were a brother in arms. And I think that actually helped the situation tremendously, because when those folks came out of the service, they had a whole different attitude about you know, the different races and how important it was to for all of us to live together and pull together. And I think that ex-servicemen actually are our greatest resource in terms of racial harmony, because, like as I said, that's one branch where, at least for the 2 years I was in, I never saw any disharmony at all in the service. And when we were overseas, and the guys would go
on the beach,
you know, we'd hit the towns and hit the bars, and the Marines were in uniform, and the sailors were in uniform. So I was on a ship, and, you know, we carried the Marines. The fights that broke out were not black and white. They were Marines versus sailors, and it didn't matter. It was the color of your uniform. It wasn't the color of your skin. So, yeah, I had a much greater appreciation for that after I did my 2 years during the Vietnam War, and I think that that's gone a long way towards helping with you know, understanding. I think that servicemen have a greater appreciation for compromise, for having to get along, to having to work together, the team approach. And I think part of the problem that we're seeing right now is that these youngsters go to college and in some places get indoctrinated into one side of politics, and learn and talk about the fact that if you don't like what you're hearing, just shut them down. Don't engage, but deny.
Cancel.
Yeah, cancel. And speaking of which, I had an interesting discourse with Jeremy Schiffers from the Freeman. I believe he's the city editor, and he's I think a proponent of canceling. And I invited him on the show. So, Jeremy, if you're listening, or if any of Jeremy's friends are listening, or coworkers, or whatever, we'd love to have Jeremy come on and share his thoughts with us. We will respect his opinions, and we may discuss them, we may argue with them, but we'd be thrilled if we could have someone of his stature come on the show with us and talk about the pros and cons of canceling. I'm interested to hear how canceling improves discourse, how it takes us to the next level. So, Jeremy, if you're listening, please give us a shout. You know how to reach you. You've known him for years at the Freeman. So come and talk to us. Come and talk to us. We'd love to hear you.
You know, it says something, I think, to where we are, that there can be a serious discussion about canceling anybody. I mean, we're actually talking about it.
Yeah.
I mean, I couldn't imagine, unless somebody absolutely insulted me, of just turning my back and walking away. I would want to discuss, try to find some common ground. And very often, it's a phone call. Okay.
Okay. Good morning, caller. Thank you for calling, and welcome to the to Kingston Community Radio.
Yes. Good morning, gentlemen. Good morning. I wanted to comment on the talking about the election and voting. And it seemed to me that with this past election, there were more votes than ever for both candidates. Both of them got more votes than any other presidential candidate in history. And, you know, due to the pandemic and folks having to, you know, we had to all work together to get votes in. It seems to me that why is Election Day only one day? Or why was that traditionally, was it always? It seems like maybe, you know, it just seems the more people that can vote, the better. And if Election Day were just one day, some folks have to work, or if they can't get there that day, that's it. It just seems that this past election showed us that when folks have more access to voting, more people will vote. Democrats, Republicans, everybody, it seems. So just your thoughts on that, or has Election Day always just been one day? Is this how it's always been, was my question.
Yes, but I didn't that Georgia legislation expand it to Saturdays?
Oh, a number of states. New York, we had early voting. California has early voting like for a month before the election.
Yeah.
So people can vote early. Now, it's expanded. Traditionally, elections were on Election Day. If you couldn't vote that day, then you could request an absentee ballot. Then with the advent, and I think the issue right now is with the advent of COVID, some states, like Pennsylvania, sent out ballots to what they considered to be every eligible voter. So no one knew if the vote was being cast by the eligible voter. No one knew if the voter was eligible or had passed away or had moved out of state. In Georgia, one of the issues was they found tens of thousands of people who had moved out of Georgia who had received ballots. And not only had they received them, they had returned them. So these were some of the issues that they're dealing with, because if you're going to send out ballots to every eligible voter, then there's an argument to be made that you have to make sure that voters are eligible. And so that means you have to actually do some work. And, you know, sometimes the election boards get a little lazy and they don't want to spend the time to clean up the rolls. Sometimes people move out of the state and don't realize, and the election board doesn't realize they moved out of state. They leave a forwarding address. For instance, ballots should not be forwarded. That should be part of the rules. If that person isn't at that address any longer, that ballot should go back. Instead, they were forwarded. You know, forwarded to Florida. They were forwarded to, and those folks returned ballots. So there were some discrepancies, not enough to, I think, affect the outcome of the election. But what people are trying to say is we have to have faith in that system. And I agree with the caller completely. I like the idea of early voting. I don't like the idea of voting too early, because I think that issues could come up. You know, if you start voting a month ahead of time, in that last month, there could be some issue, and those ballots don't come with erasers. You can't change your vote if you change your mind. So I even though we could vote early, I'm a proponent of waiting at least until the day of the election, or maybe a day before, or 2 days before, so that you can really assess all the information and cast an intelligent ballot.
And my second part of the question, thank you for that. And my second part of the question is, so people have to register to vote, but it seems like depending where you live, it's a different date you have to register by. And if you don't register, and now here it's Election Day, you can't vote because you didn't register in time. Do you think that, couldn't it just be simple, like you turn 18 and you automatically can vote? Why is there the registration part, and how come, I think it's different in different places, you have to really know where to go, you know, where to go or by which date, otherwise you miss the cutoff so you can actually vote. And maybe I'm not right on that, but can you speak to that part? Thank you so much. Love the show.
Thank you. Thank you, caller. I think they can, people who haven't registered or didn't know how to register, but see an election and they have a candidate that they want to vote for or against, they can vote by affidavit. It's a little paperwork, but it doesn't take long. You essentially sign a statement that you're a resident of this locality, and then after the election, and we see it. There's counting going on after the election,
sure,
of these affidavits and absentee ballots, but they're different. Different instruments, but the affidavit allows people, like perhaps yourself, voter, who just didn't register, but they are eligible voter. They're eligible in the sense that they're citizens. They've lived in a certain place for a period of time. Whatever the regulations are not onerous,
And I think the Board of Elections could probably do a better job on publicizing the rules. You know, that's part of it, I think, educating people on how to vote and how to get a ballot. But in answer to one part of your question, the reason that they're different in different places is because the Constitution gives the power to run elections to the states. And as a consequence, each state has the right to set up their own rules. And that's part of the Constitution, which is why H.R. 1 will probably never take effect. That's the bill before Congress to impose federal rules on the elections. First off, they can only impose rules on federal elections, not on state elections. But more importantly, even with federal elections, they probably will not pass the constitutional test, because it's clearly the Constitution gives the states the ability to establish the rules for how they elect people.
Okay.
And thank you for the call.
Okay, we got to go to break, but when we come back, we'll have birthdays.
All right.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
Think fast. In the short time it takes to listen to this message, a small flame can turn into a big fire. Several minutes more, and thick, poisonous smoke may have filled your lungs and reduced your ability to respond. Give it 5, and your entire home may be filled with flames.
Keep breathing. We got you.
Don't let your world go up in smoke. Have working smoke alarms and practice an escape plan for you and your loved ones. Learn more at usfa.fema.gov, because fire is everyone's fight.
Hi, I'm Kelsey Grammer. Wounded Warrior Project supports injured veterans by connecting them with fellow warriors, by serving them through mental health and wellness programs, and by empowering them to live on their own terms. No one should face a battle alone. Join us at WoundedWarriorProject.org.
Question: what will you find on all over-the-counter or OTC medicine packages to help you choose the right drug and use it safely? The answer: the Drug Facts label. This label lists the medicine's active ingredients and purpose, how much to take, and warnings you should know before using it. Remember, even OTC medicines you buy without a prescription can cause side effects you don't want. So follow the information listed on the Drug Facts label. For more information, visit fda.gov/drugfactslabel. A message from the U.S. Food and Drug Administration.
Introducing the YMCA. Sure, you know the Y for a swim or a game of hoops, but we're more than that. We're a cause. When you take a jump shot at the Y, someone else is getting job training. Practice yoga as a team practices her leadership skills. We give people of all ages, incomes, and backgrounds a chance to learn, grow, and thrive. So while you might think of the Y as the place for lifting weights, we're also about lifting entire communities. That's the Y. We're so much more. Visit ymca.net/more.
Hi, this is Tony Marmo from Norman Staffing, and we've been bringing together employers and job seekers since 1980. If you're an employer and have job vacancies, let Norman Staffing help fill them with permanent or temporary workers. We screen, interview, and recommend the best candidates for your company. We make the employment process easier and faster for you. Please call Norman Staffing for your employment needs at 338-9111, 338-9111, or normanstaffing.com.
Hi, this is Winnie from the Rosendale Seniors, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
Rondout Savings Bank has a long history of serving local communities and maintaining a strong tradition of customer service excellence while providing each customer with the personal attention they deserve. Rondout Savings' approach to community banking puts you and the growth of your business in the front of everything they do. They're a different kind of bank and would like to tell you why, so please reach out to one of their expert business bankers for an appointment and let them show you what they can do for you. Rondout Savings Bank, always working for you and the community with branches in Kingston, West Hurley, and Hyde Park. Also online at rondoutbank.com. Equal housing lender, member FDIC.
All right, we're back. It's 8 o'clock. It's time for birthdays. Take it away, Mario.
Okay, good morning, Kingston Community Radio listening world. We're going to do our Friday birthdays, Friday, April 2nd. We have a bunch of birthdays, and God bless these folks. So the first one is, please wish a happy birthday to Paula Ten Eyck from your friends at the Girls Night Out Book Club. The second one is, on Friday, April 2nd, please wish a happy birthday to David Spiro from your friends and family, wife and baby Fox Moses. And the third one is, please wish a happy birthday to Megan Tenor from your friends and family, husband Seth, Landon, Alana, Lucas, Mom and Dad, Sibs, Joel, and Philip. Happy birthday, Megan. So let's see. The winner today of the Boyce Dairy Milk House famous cow pie is David Spiro. Congratulations, David. It was a spirited contest today, but David prevailed. And so, David, you can pick up your cow pie at the Boyce Dairy Milk House, and that comes to you compliments of the Boyce Dairy and the Kingston Community Radio. And Saturday, tomorrow, April 3rd, we have no birthdays. But on Sunday, April 4th, we have a please wish an 80th birthday to Pauline Williams from your friends and family. Pauline, congratulations. You made the big 80. Pauline is unopposed, she is the recipient and will be the recipient of the famous cow pie. Pauline, you can pick up your cow pie at the Boyce Dairy Milk House at 62 O'Neill Street in Kingston. And that comes to you courtesy of the Boyce Dairy and Kingston Community Radio. Congratulations to all of our friends with birthdays. And now, back to the show. Back to the show. So, Huey.
Yeah.
Like to get a little conversation going. I sent you some information that I got this week, and I'm gonna bring it up about the interesting way in which our governor Cuomo deals with communication. Did you have any thoughts on that?
Well, why don't you explain it, Mario, to the listeners, and then we can comment.
All right. So there was an article. I don't know if folks read The Intercept. There's a news organization called The Intercept. They're pretty nonpartisan. I have a tendency, you know, to gravitate to nonpartisan papers, and these folks are what I consider equal opportunity abusers. It's a good, you know, it's a good situation because I mean they lean a little to the left, but not, you know, obnoxiously to the left like you know, the Washington Post or the New York Times or CNN.
I believe it was the Washington Post you mentioned before that called President Biden on his misstatements.
It was so egregious. It was so egregious. I mean, I don't want to talk about his mental acuity, but evidently he couldn't, you know, see the monitor, and he got confused about something, and so you know. Speaking of that, I have to ask you a question because you've been in the press for many years. You were a guy that when I was in politics, I had a lot of respect for. Even when I was the county chairman, you and I had an understanding that you had to do your job and I had to do my job, and we still maintained our friendship during those years. But the president finally did a press conference, and I'm interested in one perspective of it, and I really want your opinion on this. I don't think we've discussed this, but there are photographs that were taken where he had a booklet with the pictures of the various people who would be at the press conference, the 25 press folks that were invited. He had pictures, and next to the pictures, he had a sequence in which to call them. So his team said to them, you call this person first, this person second, this person third, etc. In addition to which, he had talking points, and here's what was interesting to me. He always seemed to have the correct talking point when he called on that person to answer that question. I don't know if you noticed this or not, but he was looking down and reading the points. Now, if the people were, he was told to call people in a certain sequence, and he never fumbled around to find the talking point for that question, were the folks who were being called upon, the White House press corps able to predict the questions they were going to ask? Because he had the answers ready in the same sequence in which he called the people. That to me was very strange, that they would be able to predict so that he wouldn't have to switch cards. And so it led me to believe, and I'd like your opinion, that either the folks there had asked so many questions about a certain subject that they pretty much knew what that subject would be, and so they had those talking points prepared. So I'll give them the benefit of the doubt. Or they had some inclination of what those questions might be ahead of time, and that's why he had to call people in the sequence that they told him to call. What do you think?
I'm totally confused. That's what I think. I think that this is...
Why would it matter then? Okay, let me throw it out this way. Why would it matter what sequence you called people? Why would they tell him, call this person first, this person second, this person third, this person fourth? Why would that matter?
All right. In defense of the president, this has been going on a long, long time in various iterations. It's called prepping the president. You get somebody like Jack Kennedy, who's just razor sharp.
There's no way you're going to throw a question at him that's going to befuddle him, or he won't have an answer, or he does a Jackie Gleason, you know, hammer, hammer, hammer. Now, this guy needs a lot of care and preparation. I won't comment on his acuity either, but his severest critic said Joe was not that sharp when he was 40. But on my level, when we did editorial boards with candidates at the Freeman, one or both candidates, spokespeople or advanced people, would constantly inquire and pointedly, well, what are you going to ask? And we would say, you'll find out when you get there.
Oh, okay.
You know what's in the papers. We're going to talk about topical subjects and issues that we feel our readers, as you and I do on this program, issues that we feel our readers are interested in, and we will question you about those things. So come prepared to field any kind of question. This I'm surprised that the people who manipulate media the way they do allowed any kind of cameras behind that podium, where you as a viewer could see how this thing was so carefully orchestrated.
Mm-hmm.
They're dealing with what they have, and they just can't allow.
They don't want them to. They're protecting. They are protecting him, because you're right. He probably.
But I think almost anybody, I think you could stand up there. You're still pretty sharp, despite your advanced years, could stand up there and get a question out of left field that you either hadn't studied or didn't even know about. That used to go on. I'll say one thing for Trump, and I know I'll probably be canceled for this, but he was pretty fair. I thought he was fairly, and I don't mean by comparison, I mean just to other presidents too.
Yeah.
I mean, he would, particularly when he was boarding the helicopter to go someplace.
He never ducked the question.
He did duck questions. People would yell questions out. He would respond to them. You might not like it. Certainly, a lot of people didn't like his responses, but he was right there in front of these people, unscripted. Yeah. He didn't have any kind of, three-by-five cards to
probably would have been helpful for him to duck a few questions, because
Trump talked too much.
Yeah,
but that's the way things are. I mean, you mentioned how he got some specific points on the Georgia law just flat out wrong.
Yeah,
maybe apparently that wasn't scripted.
Yeah,
but that's the way it. What can I say? You know, it's a saying, God help me discern the things I can change and the things I can't.
I was wondering.
It's not going to be changed.
The thing that surprised me is most times, the president, you know, looks around a room, picks the major, I mean, they didn't pick Fox News, the number one cable news show.
They didn't have Fox on?
They were in the room, but they didn't allow the Fox Peter Ducey to ask a question. All right, they had NPR, they had somebody from Indonesia, you know, whatever. But the number one cable news network was not allowed to ask a question at his press conference, because they couldn't, you know.
I didn't know that. It's not a legitimate press conference. People want to. There's millions of people. And then, you know, I know the right side of the ledger likes to point to the fact that 70 million people voted for this guy.
Yeah.
And their voices should be heard too. At least, as you say, Fox has the largest audience.
Yeah.
And to ignore that.
By far.
And you know,
it was not their finer moment, in my opinion.
Whatever.
I mean, at least he did a press conference. He did.
Let's get back to Cuomo now. As I understand your question, which I asked you to phrase, but then you wandered back to Georgia, or to the president's press conference. There are two major issues facing Cuomo, and I think by far the most important issue is this nursing home situation. Who did what, and
and when and who's responsible. And there is no, there's a, and the other one is the allegations as yet unproven, the allegations against the governor in terms of his treatment of staff and other women. But the first one is the most important one. There were upwards of 15,000 lives affected, lost in this. And I was not aware of this, but you and I talked about it on one of our walks, that the only two authorities that can authorize investigation of the nursing home situation is the comptroller. No, I got it backwards. The comptroller and
the governor have subpoena power. The attorney general
and the comptroller cannot investigate anything without the approval.
The attorney general in New York cannot investigate the nursing home scandal, does not have subpoena power to investigate that scandal unless she gets a referral from the governor or from the comptroller, because the comptroller is department is responsible for the nursing homes. So she cannot, and only in New York State could we have such a convoluted constitution that doesn't allow the chief law enforcement officer of the state to conduct an independent investigation. Has to have a referral from, so she's not going to get the referral from Cuomo to investigate. So the only other person who can get her that referral would be DiNapoli, the comptroller, and he has failed to do so. How long has this been going on? And she still, and that's why, by the way, we haven't heard one word.
God, I wish I would have knew that the other day when Elliot Auerbach was on, the deputy comptroller, because he was sitting in that chariot on Wednesday.
I didn't know it either.
I didn't know that until he just said it then. That it was those two people that have to initiate that.
Exactly. And that's why you haven't seen one word in the press or anywhere. No witnesses called, no nothing, because for whatever the reason, DiNapoli has not sent, I don't know what more he needs in order to get this done, but he hasn't sent the referral. And so therefore, at the moment, folks, and I'd be very interested in hearing anybody's comments on this one. At the moment, there is no current investigation by the state attorney general on the nursing home scandal. There's an investigation, I believe, going on in one of the houses. It might be the assembly or the Senate, but they don't have the ability to make any criminal referrals or criminal charges. So this is looking like the biggest whitewash, in ages, and it's very disappointing. The other thing that also came about recently was the fact that while nursing homes couldn't get COVID testing kits, the governor was sending state troopers out to the Hamptons, and one of them reported that he was there for 2 hours waiting for Chris Cuomo to take they had to get a nurse in there to do something, and 4, 6, 8. I mean, I don't know if you've ever driven out to the Hamptons. It's like a 3-hour drive each direction. So you spending a trooper sending a trooper out there 8 hours to get a swab of your brother's nose, and you've got people dying all over the place and nursing homes begging for testing kits, and they're going to donors. That was the other thing that they reported. Some of the heavy hitters were also getting tested, family members getting tested. I mean, come on. That's just totally unfair. And again, you know, I is anybody out there that thinks that was a good idea? 331-9255, Kingston Community Radio. Call in and let us know, or if you want to defend this guy, we'd love
to
hear
it. We don't want to hear no defense.
No defense is allowed.
There's no defense needed.
We're canceling him. Anyway, so just very quickly, because I also want to get on to the if we have a few moments, I'd love to discuss the shootout at the OK Corral. I mean, at Kingston.
There's been more than one shootout. There's been several. Last Thursday we had Valerie Arold and Dan Gruner on, and they are with Concerned Kingston. You know, the group of I'm sure you heard about it. So they were ripping Tinty and the mayor pretty hard. So I called Jid on Friday and said, "Hey, me and Chief Snyder had a show on Monday. I was like, you need to come on and either rebut what they're saying, or, you know, let's hear what you have to say on this." Yeah, I'll be there. Never showed up. Didn't show up for the radiothon on Wednesday. And I think either his hands are tied by the mayor, or, you know, something's not right, because, you know, they're not on the same page with each other. When that 12-year-old girl got killed while she was sleeping, that should have been there should have been an outcry right then and there. And from what they were saying last Thursday, that the police, they just drive by now. They don't even do anything unless there's a 911 call. The PBA president was on for Kingston, slamming Tinty and the rest of his brass, which would never happen 30 years ago.
He'd be walking the beat.
Walking the beat, or he'd be walking home without a job.
Yeah.
Or walking home.
Yeah.
Wouldn't have a squad car to drive in, that'd be for sure.
It sounds like the wheels are coming off in more ways than one. And you know, I don't know if anybody. I know we're on the subject of the increase in crime and especially crime with weapons. But if anybody knows what happened to Urgent, you know, there was a time when we had a very active Urgent group that really seemed to be locked into the drug crime. I have a feeling a lot of these crimes are drug related, you know, and of course we don't have the Urgent guys out there anymore short circuiting these kinds of situations. If anybody out there knows what happened to Urgent, or why we don't hear that anymore, what we don't hear from them any longer, we'd be interested in knowing, because to me it seems very coincidental that all of a sudden we don't hear from Urgent anymore, and
there is no more Urgent.
And they're shooting up the city.
Yeah, there's no more Urgent, or it's very, very small. And there's also Kingston. I think the Kingston Police Force used to have a narcotics division. Like, they had their own, you know, task force to go out and bust the bad guys. That's disbanded. There's only one of them now. He rides around in a patrol car. This all started when the bail reform went in. The criminals aren't stupid. They know unless you kill somebody, you're not going to jail. Someone could rob your house tonight, Mario. They could catch him right in the front yard with your, you know, trophies and whatever you got in your house. You're going to get your stuff back, but they're going to get let go of the ticket.
They're going to find them in the front yard, all right. But they're going to be full of 12-gauge.
I didn't mean that.
They're going to be full of 12-gauge shots.
Yeah.
I can guarantee that, because I don't have to reach very far for that shotgun.
Well, that's good. You have the right to bear arms, but
You
have the right to remain silent.
I have the right to shoot.
You have the right to a lot of things.
Anyone but dumb enough to walk into my house uninvited, too.
Seriously, though, it's not all Tinty and the mayor's fault.
First, they have to get over the moat, though, right?
Yeah. This stems from lawmakers in Albany getting rid of bail. You know, I just found out a month ago. You want to hear something ridiculous?
Listen, we only got about half an hour, and there's a few subjects I'd like to raise. There is a front page story in the Freeman this morning that a Common Council committee is unanimously supporting the city spending $500,000 from its contingency fund. This is no state or federal grant.
to study the city's zoning plan, which was last adopted in 1963. So obviously, a lot of things have changed. However,
and by the way, that's about $20 per person living in the city.
Yeah.
Can I have my 20 bucks? I mean,
can they fix the roads maybe before they decide to do that?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We're getting there. Will you please, Walter?
Lawrence.
No, I'm calling him Walter because he used to do the same thing. Walter would jump in the middle of a conversation, which is all right. No, thank you. Thank you, Lawrence. Lawrence with an A-U.
Yeah.
That's how it's spelled. But I think this is this may or may not be necessary. It's probably necessary to update a zoning plan every 60 years or so. You have to wonder why it took 60 years for them to look at it seriously. But it seems to me that as spending $500,000 of taxpayer money, this is right out of the taxpayers directly. That there's other ways they could do this. We have a very well-staffed, professional county planning department that deals on these issues all the time. In fact, you know from your own service in the legislature that when a town passes a zoning change, that it has to be reviewed by the county.
Yeah, I was on the town of Ulster zoning commission and on the planning board.
So, yeah. So this is money that shouldn't be coming. I could see maybe the city paying for a part of it. Maybe even $100,000 is a lot.
Maybe even a consultant to help with
to guide it. But I mean, and this isn't rocket science either. I mean, zoning has been around for 100 years,
and it'll be a miracle if they change 10 or 15 parcels. Because, everything's built on this. There's very little land around here to change anything with.
Yeah, so that's not a good thing. And speaking of development.
By the way, I went into the wrong business. If some guy can get paid $500,000
for a year's work.
Yeah, that R1 zoning for that house ought to stay R1.
Yeah,
walk down the street and every house, every lot's built on, and they're all R1.
Well, you were on the zoning board. These things can get complicated. Ulster, you know, with what they call Woodstock, New Paltz, they have fairly complicated, strict zoning laws, which leads me to. I was surprised by this, quite frankly, that the would be developers. Of the former Lasher funeral home in Woodstock, which is a substantial piece of property. I believe it's about 4 acres.
Yeah, beautiful.
With a creek that runs under the funeral home. They came to town with ideas to build a single family housing there and a kind of a boutique hotel on that site. Some townsfolk protested that plan. They came back with another plan, which was different. They came back with a third plan that was different. I think they eliminated the housing portion of it. They seem to be people who are willing to work with the community to come up with something.
Yeah.
Something that was agreeable, and then they walked away from it.
When they walk away, they've already invested a substantial amount of money. Because you have to go in there, you have to do plans, you have to hire engineers, you have to hire architects, designers, this, that. You've got to do studies, you've got to do traffic studies, etc. This isn't just, handing somebody a piece of paper and whatever. There's a substantial investment, and I don't know. I don't live in Woodstock, but I've heard rumors that they're pretty difficult to deal with because there's an entire element in that community that doesn't want anything to change. And, that's they won the day, it appears, and I don't know. Shame on them. There's an article in there somewhere also, I believe it was either yesterday or today, about how the folks in Woodstock, there's some committee there that wants more affordable housing. They want housing alternatives. Yet when somebody tried to build affordable housing behind Bradley Meadows,
That was a RUPCO project, right?
Yeah, the RUPCO. I mean, it was virtually impossible. If it was anybody else other than RUPCO, never probably would have gotten done. Those folks know their way around these governments. But, I just don't get it. If you want housing, let somebody come in and build housing.
You know, it got done. And it's a show place.
It's gorgeous.
It's well done, well planned. Kevin O'Connor is a leading environmentalist. The types of projects that Marco puts together, it's been my experience over a long period that these projects are proposed. They're opposed. It's in the paper every day. They fight tooth and nail.
Mm-hmm.
They get built, and not just in this case an artist community project. Kind of hard to understand how a starving artist project would be opposed in Woodstock, which is the art colony, but nonetheless it was. But and you never hear from it again. It's in place. It's the
fully occupied.
Fully occupied. The neighbors adjust to whatever traffic. Traffic's always an issue. It's the first thing that they raise. You know. Let's talk about. We talked about the late budget, didn't we?
Yes, we did.
Yeah. And I think we pretty much beat pot to death last week. But now it's going to be the law, the marijuana law.
Yeah. Yeah. Getting stoned legally, you know. It's very interesting because I had some relatives who lived in Colorado when they I believe were the first or either the first or second state to legalize it, and they opened up the shops and business was booming. They would tell me that. The shops would open at 9, and 8 o'clock in the morning, the lines started to form.
Wow.
And I hate to say this because I would hope that folks would have more honorable reasons, but in one of the articles, I can't remember which of our elected officials was talking about this, but one of the great benefits was the fact that it could raise $450 million a year in taxes for New York State. So they're talking about taxing and not necessarily the expense that's going to be associated with legalizing another mind-altering, coordination-altering substance. So the biggest problem that happened in Colorado, and I have no idea, maybe we can get somebody on to explain this to us, but the biggest problem that Colorado had is when you're drinking, the officer says, please blow in this tube, and they can immediately tell what your blood alcohol content is. When you're stoned and you're driving erratically or you're causing an accident, they don't know. There's no test at the moment that I'm aware of. I understand there's some being developed now as a consequence of this, but there's no test that I'm aware of to say you drove impaired. So what's the impairment limit? So and the blood alcohol is 0.8 or 0.08 or whatever it is. Okay, 0.08. What's the legal blood cannabis threshold before you're considered driving while impaired? That was the biggest problem in Colorado because of the number of auto accidents, the increase in accidents, and the fact that the police did not have the ability to assess whether or not that person was driving impaired. So now, if they don't figure out how to do this in a hurry, we're going to wind up having a substantial number of impaired drivers on the road. The other interesting sidebar to this was the only other complaint that I ever got from the folks that I knew that lived there was that it appeared that a lot of the checkout people would make mistakes. Charge, you know, going, you go into a Whole Foods or someplace of that nature, and the person checking you out is all glassy-eyed, and they'd either charge some for something twice or they'd forget to charge for something. They
That's a good thing.
I know, but, you know, the point was a lot of what they said was a lot of the low-end folks, the job market, seemed to, because the employers couldn't check to see if somebody was stoned. And so people with boring jobs were getting ripped during work, after work, before work, and they said the level of services declined fairly rapidly after the legalization began. So those were just a couple of anecdotal stories.
Let me ask you this, Mario. You're a dentist. You have a large staff, as I recall. Some of them, most of them are younger people. They're not old folks like us.
Most of them are younger than me.
Well, most people are younger than us. But you manage this business as, you know, one of the I think you could be fairly defined as the managing partner of your practice. What kind of thought have you given to your employees coming out? I mean, these people have drills in their hands.
Well,
can you screen people for this? Apparently not.
Well, yeah, we kind of have a zero tolerance policy. I've had a situation where, I have a personal, and I always have had, a personal policy that if I was working the next day, I wouldn't drink the night before. And definitely didn't drink, you know, didn't go out to lunch and have a martini or anything on days when I was seeing patients. We have had incidences of our employees going out and having a drink with lunch, and the first time it's a warning, and the second time it's dismissal. That's always been our policy. We had the same policy with marijuana because, you know, it's all over the place. And what's interesting is you get, when you're working in close proximity to people, you really get to know their work habits, and sometimes you can detect the change in and behavior, and question it, and warn them, and, you know, dismissal is permissible, at least in our business, for anybody who's impaired.
And yet there's no way to screen for that.
At the moment, no. Most of the times, their coworkers ratted them out. You know, so-and-so had a drink during lunch, or so-and-so, you know, smoked a joint during lunch. Okay. That was usually how it happened. But, yeah, we've dismissed a few people. I had to dismiss a dentist once.
Wow.
Yep.
Moving to another subject, this is a quote-unquote local election year, and people are running from family court judge down to town council.
Yeah.
And I believe the deadline was late last month for filing petitions.
Mm-hmm.
And it appears that there'll be seven uncontested seats in the county legislature.
I think yes.
It was five and two.
Five seats are guaranteed to the Democrats and two to the Republicans.
Yeah.
So the Dems start with a three-vote margin.
Yeah.
Which is substantial.
Yeah. I've heard from people who follow this stuff a little closer than I do, you know, projections. That the legislature currently is 12, 11 Democrat with some odd combinations of non-enrolled and caucusing with, and we might mention John Parity in the context of this conversation, but of real Democratic dominance, maybe 15 seats, 15 to 8, which goes back to the glory days of the Republican Party, when I think when you were a legislator, it was like, was 33, like 26-7?
It was 28-5.
Yeah.
It was terrible.
It was just overwhelming. One of the things I like about a divided legislature is that every vote really counts.
Yeah.
When you got 12-11, your voice is heard. When you got 28-5, they can marginalize half a dozen legislators who don't agree with them. But the notion of seven vacant, essentially seven uncontested seats, suggests to me that having 23 legislators in a county with 180,000 people is just is just too much. Particularly in the modern era, as defined, the executive era since 2009, where the executives, for better or worse, assumed almost all the duties of the legislature. And For legislators running
and the legislature has graciously allowed the executive to essentially become both
both branches. Yeah.
Both branches.
And for legislators to go around to say that we control policy and the purse, it probably sounds pretty good door to door for people who don't pay attention, but in fact they do neither. They rubber stamp the budget, they sniff around the edges. A couple of $100,000 may go in.
And God forbid somebody like Lynn Archer asks a few questions, and she's toast.
Yeah, yeah.
And see you around, Lynn.
Yeah.
Hasta la vista, baby.
Hasta la vista.
Yeah, baby. Don't be asking any tough questions here, you know what I'm saying?
This is the no questions
zone. We don't want to offend the executive.
No, not at all. But it leads me to advocate again for a reduced legislature. I don't think we need more than 15 legislators.
Here's my opinion right off the bat was that, Jerry Benjamin's a friend of mine. I was offered a seat on the Charter Commission. And I turned it down because I thought I was too busy to do a good job. And I wish when I saw the final product, I was like distraught. You know, but first of all, you know, my undergraduate degree was history and government, so I knew quite a bit about local governments, charters, things of that nature. Professor Benjamin's a history professor. It was obvious that he failed math, when he was in school, because who in their right mind would put in a provision in a charter that said that the in order to override a vote, you have to have a two-thirds vote, and then not put in the same amount of legislators that you could divide by three. So if you follow what I'm saying, if they had gone to 21 legislators, you divide it by three, you override 14-7. You put in 23 legislators, you have to have 16-7 in order to override, and that's a 74% vote. So it's almost a three-quarters vote of the legislature because somebody couldn't do the math. And
maybe somebody did the math.
Yeah, you're right. And they decided to give the executive even more power because they right now they need over a 70% vote in order to override a veto. It's insane. At the very least, they should reduce to 21. And the problem is to reduce to 15. They probably could have done it this year because five legislators weren't running. So right off the bat, you're down to 18. But the problem that you have is in order to get that vote on the ballot, because it has to be every charter change amendment. Has to be, yeah. Every amendment has to be voted on in the next election. In order to get it on, the legislature has to approve it before it can go on the ballot. They have to approve it going on the ballot. So that, to me, I mean, I'm not sure. I have to check the charter again if there's a way for citizens to do this without the legislature. I'm not sure there is.
I don't think there is.
Yeah. So another idiot consequence of allowing the people who you want to regulate to actually have a chokehold on whether or not it can even appear on the ballot. So when I was the Republican chairman, I told them I thought that we should reduce the size of the legislature, and they looked at me like I was cross-eyed. You know, what are you talking about? You know, why would you want to do that? I mean, these are jobs.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, oh, you know.
And they're not bad jobs. They're it's $14,000 a year for the rank and file.
Yeah.
Which essentially, for most of them, is two meetings a month. They go to their committee meeting.
Remote.
Now they don't even go.
Yeah. They're sitting home eating popcorn and you know, having a good old time. But the point of the matter is that you're absolutely right. It has to be something. It has to be an odd number divisible by three. 18 is divisible by three, but you could wind up with a 9-9 vote, so you can't do it. So it's got to be either 21 or it's got to be 15. Those are the two options. 9's probably too few. But 15, if I'm not mistaken, I think Dutchess County may have 15 or 16.
You're thinking of Orange County.
Oh, Orange County, yeah. Small legislature. You don't, I mean, I can easily be represented, by a legislature. Now, and by the way, let me just say this. Should that occur, the Republicans don't stand a chance, because the bigger the districts get, the more Democratic they get. Mm. Up until now, they've been able to, with 20 towns and 23 seats, the commission that drew the lines the last time tried to maintain town integrity. Putting two towns together or one town or, as a consequence, you didn't have districts where, for instance, if they wanted to permanently make the town of Ulster a Democratic seat, they would just combine enough seats from the city of Kingston and that would be it. But when they kept the town's integrity, they were able to keep Kingston Democratic. Sorgatys was up in the air, but Marbletown and Marlboro and, you know, some were Plattekill were maintained Republican. So there were very few swing votes. There were about five. Even now, there are very few swing votes. But if you, pardon me, if you want my opinion, I think if the Republicans can win nine votes in
seats,
it'll be a good day. I just don't see it happening. Now, Parity dropped out. I was counting him as a vote, as a seat, and he aligned with the Republicans. He's still in a battle with the Democrats, but
he might have been the first politician to be canceled.
Yeah,
by the Democrats. Mm-hmm. His obit will read like a very prominent Democrat. This guy has held some of the most important offices in the county. Yeah. He was a legislature chairman. He's
election commissioner, Democratic election commissioner.
Election commissioner.
Chairman of the legislature.
Yeah. John spoke truth to power. I respected him for that during the Hine administration. He always lost. I don't think he ever won any of his battles. At least during that period, but he was outspoken and he would challenge the executive, and at a time when no one else dared question Hine, and he was pretty much eliminated. He had some epic battles with Kathy Nolan, who was essentially a representative of the executive. For better or for worse, and
she was against the big project.
Stop that thing!
Yeah,
you know, that's something. Maybe a future show, because we should go into some depth on that. But holy cow! You know that
been project going on for how many? 10 years now?
20
years.
It's actually the last century. 1998. That project was brought forth, mm-hmm. and now we're. It's 23 years. Holy cow. Time does go by, doesn't it?
You want to know why there are no jobs.
And how many iterations did that project go through to satisfy, or attempt to satisfy critics, and the critics just came up with more?
And they've already deeded property to the state.
A thousand acres, they get forever wild, which they bought, assembled and bought. Dean Gitter died before it ever,
ever
got off the drawing board. And spring is here. The building season starts soon. I'm not predicting any shovels in the ground this year.
No.
Something else will happen.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable. Anyway, we're running out of time here. We have about 8 minutes. Anything else on our mind? Give them the phone number again.
All right. Well... Anybody out there still awake after this? 331-9255, Kingston Community Radio. Mario, Huey, and we'd love to hear your thoughts on any of this wide-ranging discussion. One of the things that I'm finding very interesting are outreach programs and that were mandated by the governor on policing. And, you know, I saw recently where they signed off on the one from Ulster County. What I thought was very interesting was never heard a word from any legislator on it. Now, I'm not sure that any legislator even gave testimony at any of the hearings. I'm not sure the legislature had any hearings. I was always under the impression that they promoted themselves as being the policymakers.
Yeah.
This is clearly a policy. And I think they just rubber stamped it, if I'm not mistaken. I'm not even sure. I'm not sure how the vote went or if they even voted. I'm just so. But the thing that got me was how the folks who are doing this are promoting this as a way to reduce crime. And in the
I would disagree with that, Mario. I don't think that's the main emphasis of this. I think it's more about it's not about reducing crime. That's the law and order contingent. This is not about. I don't believe this is about law and order. This is about equity, which is the new buzzword.
And they said, you know, that the community, you know, with the police working with the communities, it's going to reduce crime.
Looks good on paper. Tinty has been talking about community policing since
he's been doing it. He's been doing it.
Well, you call Kingston the OK Corral, right?
Oh, listen, shoot him up. Shoot him up, Kingston. I mean, would you honestly, and answer this question honestly, would you walk down Broadway after dark?
My mom won't even go to Sea Deli when the daylight is out, you know. A guy got killed on Liberty Street at 1 o'clock in the afternoon a couple Sundays ago. Luckily, they caught him 2 days later with the help of the community. But do you know now, if you go in front of a grand jury and the witness comes forward, that used to be under lock and key.
Yeah.
It was sealed. It's not anymore. The defense attorney, within 24 hours, is notified of who the witness is. And who came up with that idea? Now people are afraid to be a witness. So, I mean, I think it starts from, you know, no bail. They know they're not going to get in trouble unless they murder somebody. Right now there's like three or four. I know several correction officers in Ulster County Jail. There's like 10 inmates in there. Okay? And they're all in there for serious crimes or awaiting, or have already been convicted and are waiting to go, you know.
State prison.
Upstate. Yeah, upstate prison.
So, just to add a little insult to injury here. There was a lot of publicity about the poor Asian woman in New York City who was attacked. Come to find out that the person who attacked her was out on what's known as lifetime parole. All right? Out on parole. Do you know what his crime was? Lawrence, do you know what his crime was?
No, I saw the article in the Post.
All right, well, I'll tell you what his crime was. He killed his mother.
Oh, my God.
Okay, absolutely. He killed his mother. He stabbed her to death. And this guy...
How did he get released?
This guy went to prison, and then they decided that he was eligible for lifetime parole, which meant that... He would be on parole. He'd have to report to a parole board, whatever, but he didn't really have to stay in prison any longer. And voila. Exhibit A. Exhibit A. He goes out and, you know, virtually beats this woman to death on the sidewalk, screaming ethnic slurs and whatever. And now he's, you know, now they've revoked his parole. Wow. I am shocked. I am shocked. I mean, this. I have no idea what they expect, and the parole board was asked to comment on how this guy got parole, and they refused to answer.
Sounds like our governor.
They refused to share with the press their reasoning for paroling him.
Well, people get out on parole who murdered people all the time.
I mean, look at Ray Caruth. Stabbed his mother to death.
Yeah, no, I know.
Well, that's your mother, whether it's a stranger. Crime. It's murder, and they
he's definitely not going to heaven.
You know the old joke about the guy.
He didn't do 20 years, Hugh. He did about 3 years.
The old joke.
That's terrible. Yeah,
the old joke about the guy was married to a shrew, and he lived with her. He wouldn't whatever religious purposes they lived together in agony. And his buddy said to him, "You know, if you'd killed her, you would have been out by now."
Jeez. Well, listen, Hugh and Mario, thank you for a great show. We'll see you back in 2 weeks. Maybe in 2 weeks from now, maybe we can tackle the mayor and maybe get the mayor and the chief of police in here.
I think that's a good idea. We're going to ask.
Good luck with that.
Well, I've been trying all week, and I've obviously you haven't seen them on. So you guys have a great weekend. Happy Easter.
Yes.
And we'll be back on Monday, folks, with Medical Monday.